Hallo, ich bin Ena, 29 Jahre alt und vom großen Katze Q-Team. Ich wurde in Zagreb, Kroatien geboren und habe dann in Leipzig Physik studiert. Jetzt promoviere ich am Helmholtz-Zentrum Dresden-Rosendorf und arbeite meistens im Hochfeldmagnetlabor. Ich bin sozusagen in der verrückten Quantenwelt zu Hause, die du im Spiel Katze Q kennengelernt hast. Hier erforsche ich magnetische Phänomene, die in Zukunft ganz neue technische Möglichkeiten eröffnen könnten. Auch bei Katze Q spielt Magnetismus eine Rolle. Und über die App habt ihr uns wieder tolle Bonusfragen geschickt. Heute geht es um Haufen Magnete, Superanziehungskräfte und wofür diese nützlich sind.
What will happen if I put a whole bunch of magnets together? That's what 9-year-old Sophia from Canada wants to know.
That's a tricky question. Maybe you already tried this, Sophia. Magnets, for example, refrigerator magnets, can be stacked neatly. They stick to each other and act together like a big magnet.
But what is a magnet anyway?
In everyday life, we usually use the term to refer to objects that always have a magnetic field with them and thus attract iron or some other metals. They're called permanent magnets. We use them as magnetic clasps on cupboard doors, bags, or as refrigerator magnets. In QUANTube Part 3, we explain how a refrigerator magnet works, where the magnetic properties come from, and what this has to do with quantum physics. Just watch it.
But why do magnets attract or repel each other?
Every magnet has a north and a south pole. This refers to two ends of the magnet where the strongest magnetic forces are at work. By the way, the core of the Earth is also a giant magnet. Maybe you already heard about the Earth's magnetic field, but more about that later. The following applies to the magnetic poles. The opposites attract, and like magnetic poles, repel each other.
So what happens to magnets thrown randomly into a stack?
We place a handful of magnets close to each other. Remember, every magnet has a north and a south pole. The magnets will arrange themselves in a way that north and south pole always meet, because they attract each other. You get a chain of magnets in between which strongest magnetic forces are at work. That's why you can only separate them again with difficulty. By the way, if you cut a magnet into two, two new small magnets will be created, each one with a north and south pole. As far as we know today, it is impossible to create a single magnetic pole.
Can magnets be forced into a completely different arrangement?
Well, they don't like that. They get frustrated quickly. Try to lay down a kind of star out of magnets where three instead of two magnetic poles always meet. A difficult situation. Only two out of the three magnetic poles can be opposites and attract each other. The third one in the group will always repel one of the others. There's no possibility for all poles to attract each other and for the arrangement to be stable. Because one of the pairs of the magnetic poles is always dissatisfied, we call such an arrangement magnetically frustrated. That is why magnets will not stay in this position.
So what's the use of a frustrated magnet?
In QUANTube Part 3, we explain that electrons and thus atoms can behave like teeny tiny bar magnets, and what Einstein, whom you know from Wikipedia, has to do with it. Now, there are materials in which the atoms are formed in type of triangles, which I described earlier. The atoms are frustrated, and the materials built out of such atoms develop extraordinary properties. What can be done with these materials? That is what we want to find out with our research. Maybe they will be used in quantum computers. Find out what they will be able to do in the future in the Wikipedia. They also play a role in QUANTube Part 5.
Anthony, 14, from the US, wants to know, how do magnetic forces defy physics?
They do not. Magnetism is a physical phenomenon that we have known for about a very long time. About 2,600 years ago, magnetic stones or magnetic minerals formed by volcanoes were discovered by a scientist, Thales of Milet. However, we can only really understand magnetism through quantum physics, or more precisely, through the combination of relativity and quantum physics. Please check out QUANTube Part 3 for more information. It's completely different with electromagnets. Maybe you already heard of them?
Electromagnets can only generate a magnetic field if electric current is flowing, that is, if electrons are moving. Permanent magnets, on the other hand, always have their magnetic field with them.
Electromagnets are used in computer hard disks, microwaves, loudspeakers, and many other devices. As early as the 19th century, their behavior was explained through laws and equations. Things are more complicated with permanent magnets and behavior of certain materials in the magnetic fields. This is where classical physics fails and quantum physics comes into play. Quantum physics states that an electron in an atom with its negative charge does not only revolve around a nucleus as was previously thought. It has an intrinsic spin. Put simply, it means it spins around its own axis. Through this spin, the electron generates its own magnetic field and therefore becomes a tiny bar magnet.
A very advantageous combination of permanent magnets and electromagnets can be seen in the electric motor, which also powers electric cars, elevators, and washing machines.
Every electric motor contains an electric magnet and a permanent magnet. The electric motor makes the use of the fact that magnetic poles either attract or repel each other. This makes the car move. This is because the rotary motion that ultimately makes the wheels roll is created precisely through a combination of these forces. The advantage of the electromagnet is that it can be switched on and off as required, its poles can be swapped, and its field strength can be regulated, or otherwise the magnets would stick to each other and the motor would stop. The permanent magnet is comparatively more stronger and lighter. In recent decades, electromotors have become increasingly more compact and powerful. Such high-performance motors use supermagnets, which are composed of compounds known as rare earths. They're a result of quantum-based material science. One example is neodymium magnets, which are composed of chemical compounds neodymium, iron, and boron, NdFeB for short. They're among the strongest permanent magnets in the world, capable of holding 1,300 times their own weight. By the way, the ultra-stickiness and super-strong magnetic forces are used in refrigerator magnets, wind turbines, and hobby model construction.
The last exciting question is literally earth-shaking. A Kitty Q fan wants to know, why do the two magnetic poles of the Earth move?
The Earth's magnetic field is responsible for beautiful auroras, and much more importantly, it protects us against the dangerous solar storms. Last but not least, it helps with orientation, since the navigation of the migratory birds works on the basis of the Earth's magnetic field, just like a compass. The Earth's magnetic field is generated in super hot liquid core of the Earth, where temperatures exceed 6,000 degrees Celsius. While the metals in the outer core of the Earth are liquid, they're solid in the inner core due to the enormous pressure. Due to the temperature differences, the liquid metals in the outer core move in a helical pattern. Together with the rotation of the Earth, this creates a magnetic field. Like other magnets, the Earth has a north and a south pole. But beware the pitfall. The Earth's magnetic north pole is only actually a few hundred kilometers away from the geographical south pole. The magnetic south pole, in turn, is located in northern Canada. Unlike other permanent magnets, the Earth's magnetic field is not rigid. Its poles are constantly in motion, among other things, due to the rotation of the Earth. For example, the Earth's magnetic south pole turns around 40 kilometers a year to the northwest. The Earth's magnetic north pole in Antarctica also doesn't stay still and shifts away from the geographical south pole. However, the cause of the wandering of the Earth's poles is not yet fully understood. What happens in the Earth's core is very complicated. Even small irregularities can have large effects on strength and the position of the Earth's magnetic field in the long term. That is why the magnetic field is not always the same, but changes through different geological epochs. Crazy! In the history of the Earth, the magnetic south and north pole have swapped their positions several times, once about every 500,000 years. And now have fun with Kitty Q and see you in the next episode of Science Break.